The oxygen saturation tool is a very inexpensive, less than $50 item that you can pick up. And it really gives you a clue to a few things. It allows you to see in the most peripheral portion of the body whether it's picking up any type of pulse, which you can see it is. It also gives you the oxygen saturation of that tissue there. Now, notice that you can get oxygen saturation monitors that have waveform, and you can pick up arrhythmia. Picking up an arrhythmia in the lower extremity is often the entry point for beginning to understand the arrhythmia that they're having at either upper or lower chambers in the heart. It's important to pick up because if somebody has an arrhythmia, you're going to think about adequacy of magnesium, adequacy of essential fatty acid, too much or slow biodetoxification of caffeine, or many of the other medications in cardiometabolic syndrome that affect magnesium, potassium, excretion, think diuretics, or requirements, think diets that are high in sodium. You're going to pick it up by picking up an arrhythmia or picking up increased tone in the peripheral vascular system. The reason we do this test is because when you raise the leg 16 to 18 inches off the ground and watch the oxygen saturation for 15 seconds, if it stays stable and does not drop greater than 2%, then it has a greater likelihood ratio of predicting greater sensitivity and specificity of predicting peripheral vascular disease than the ankle arm index. So that's what we do, and it's just important, no matter what abnormal finding you find on physical exam, you're thinking about protein, fats, carbohydrates, the many different minerals, vitamins, and phytonutrients that all play a role in peripheral vascular health. You start hearing at 142, it's most dominant at 112. Okay. Now we'll check the upper arm, the brachial artery, and we will be able to calculate the ankle brachial index or the ankle arm index, two different terms for the same thing. And we will take the ankle systolic pressure and we will divide it by the arm systolic pressure and we will calculate the ankle brachial index. And it should be greater than 0.9. When you're taking the brachial pressure, first thing you should do is make sure you feel the brachial pulse, which is under my index finger. And you first make sure that you have an idea of where it extinguishes, where you stop feeling the pulse. Which is right around 120. You usually stop feeling the pulse at a lower pressure than you can hear the pulse doing a normal blood pressure. So then you position the bell or the brachial artery. You position the gauge where you can see it. Then we know it extinguished around 120, so I'm going to take it points above that. 142. Over 78. So we know from his ankle Doppler that we started picking up a Doppler pulse at around 140. And we also note that it was loudest at around between 110 to 116. With a stethoscope, which is less sensitive than the Doppler, we picked up his systolic at 142. So we know his ankle arm index is greater than 0.9. So there's no indication by numbers or calculations that he has peripheral vascular disease. And what you've already seen is that you've seen that he has good perfusion and color of his feet. He has really fine hair distribution. And there's no indication of edema or sores or any other issues that would suggest he does have peripheral vascular disease. So the ankle arm or ankle brachial index in this patient is really consistent with his clinical exam. When the patient is supine and you're checking for JVD, jugular venous distension, it's a perfect time to check the carotids. This is part of the vascular exam that is easily accessible. So first, when checking the carotids, we have the patient move their head slightly to the side because the carotid artery is going to move right along the internal aspect of the sternocleidomastoid. This helps it be uncovered. You're going to first auscultate. For the rare patient that has significant stenosis of the carotid artery, you don't want to miss a Bruit. You can accentuate a Bruit by having the patient take their thumb on their hand, put it in their mouth. Okay, you can relax. And you will hear a shift in the external to internal carotid blood flow, which can accentuate a murmur. Think about this if a person has intermittent vision loss in one eye, and check the carotid on the side of the eye that they have the intermittent vision loss. You may uncover carotid stenosis. Once you assure yourself that you really don't have any Bruit, then you can safely palpate the carotid artery. And you're palpating the common carotid artery as it moves up and splits the carotid bulb into the external and internal carotid. Now, if your internal jugular is there, it can overlie part of the pulse of the carotid, but in all honesty, the internal jugular should not have a pulse that you can palpate. Now what you're trying to do is make sure that the carotid pulse and the radial pulse are palpated at approximately the same time. This helps you be assured that there's no obstruction in the upper extremity by either abnormal vasculature, even thoracic outlet, or there's not a subclavian steal. Supervalvular aortic stenosis syndrome, you will have asymmetry between the right and left pulses. And that goes directly back to the pathology of that condition. So it's important to look for symmetry in pulsation between the neck, the upper extremities, between the upper extremities, lower extremities, and right to left. Now, if there is carotid disease, don't forget about the mouth. We know that 70% of people have significant plaque in their carotids, in their coronary arteries, when that plaque is harvested and they look at the bacteria in that plaque, 70% of the time it's of mouth origin. So often when I have some, when I'm checking someone's carotid, I'll just have them turn me, open their mouth, stick out their tongue, say ah, and when they do that, thank you, when they do that, you take a quick glance at their gums, at the amount of coating on their tongue, and you get an idea whether you need to do further evaluation, not only of their mouth, their flora, but how that might be relating to their carotid arteries. So when checking orthostatic blood pressures, we of course check the first blood pressure line down. Depending on what your patient's symptoms are and whether they have syncope or they say that anytime they stand up they begin to gray out, then you actually may do a three-step orthostatic blood pressure check. You may have them check their blood pressure line down, then sitting, and then standing, recording systolic, diastolic blood pressure and pulses at each stage. Now, manual blood pressures are frequently used. More and more, the automatic cuffs are being used. When would you not use an automatic cuff when you're checking someone's orthostatic blood pressures? Well, if you feel their pulse and they have any type of arrhythmia, then the oscillating automatic cuff will not be accurate and will become very painful because it is looking for a number of beats in a row to count as normal. And if there's any irregularity, then it still hunts for normal. So if you have patients with atrial fibrillation or patients who have significant hypotension because of medication or they have inadequacy of sodium or inadequacy of calcium, and they are hypotensive, or if you have a patient who's malnourished, cachectic, anorexic, and they just don't have enough autonomic function to maintain and vasoconstrict, then you're not going to use an automatic cuff. You're not going to get an accurate pressure. And so you have to be comfortable truly with using the manual cuff and also having the automatic cuff available for the routine things. Always, no matter what the finding is, think about adequacy of protein, amino acids for neurotransmitter control and balance. Think about adequacy of essential fatty acids. Think about adequacy of your minerals, your vitamins and phytonutrients that are really outlined exquisitely in the companion guide that is available to you on the Insight site. If I could have you stand up. So the thing you're really looking for with orthostatic changes does position change cause a change in pulse, an increased rapidity of pulse, a drop in systolic blood pressure by 20 or 30 points, and what are the symptoms that the patient's having when that happens? So what are the abnormal findings that you might see when you're checking orthostatic blood pressures? First, if the person starts having symptoms, inquire. Are they feeling lightheaded? They feel unsteady? Do things start to gray out? If that happens, the immediate things you think about are not nutritional things. Immediate things you think about are what is blocking the normal physiologic response to allow the blood pressure to increase because there's vasoconstriction and the pulse to increase when there's need for increased cardiac output. So if a person's symptomatic, you have to ask yourself why. Now normally, there's 500 to 1,000 cc's of blood change that goes in the splanchnic beds, okay? So if somebody's just eaten and there's vasodilation around their in their viscera, then, you know, there can be some blood pressure issues. If somebody has POTS, positional orthostatic tachycardic syndrome, and you document that, initially by doing the orthostatic changes, then, you know, therapeutically you can think about increasing vitamin D or checking D, increasing B12, because of their different roles in neurotransmitter balance that helps control the autonomic response. But the next thing you do if somebody's symptomatic and it seems to be a new orthostatic change is go to what they may have added in medications or over-the-counter medications, okay? So go back to their medication list, which is well outlined in the companion guide, as to what are the many different medications that are associated with orthostatic hypotension. And this becomes far more frequent and common in the elder. So with each passing decade, the chance of having orthostatic changes on physical exam should cue you to look at not only their nutritional status, adequacy of protein, fats, carbohydrates, minerals, vitamins, and phytonutrients, but also the other confounders that play such a role in orthostatic changes, frequent falls, or unsteadiness in our patients. If he has adequacy of autonomic tone, if his adrenals are not fatigued, if he does not have an endocrinopathy that affects his ability to vasoconstrict and maintain blood pressure, if he does not have any issues with vagal communication, vagal tone, and the connectivity with his HPATG axis, his renin-angiotensin system, so he can vasoconstrict and maintain a pulse pressure, then you're not going to see him become symptomatic, and you're not going to see the blood pressure drop or the pulse change. Certain medications, as you know, will block the ability of the heart rate to increase. So we're talking beta blockers, we're talking some of the alpha blockers, where you're getting changes in blood pressure and we have taken away pharmacologically the normal physiologic response. So if you have abnormality where the pulse drops, or the pulse increases 30 points, you have to think about volume depletion. If a person's blood pressure drops and their pulse does not increase, then you have to think about what is blocking the baroreceptors, what is blocking the chronotropic response in the SI and AV node receptors that doesn't allow this patient to maintain adequacy in heart rate and adequacy in blood pressure to change. Things that will do that, somebody becomes severely hyponatremic, they're malnourished, you see that, you're cachectic or anorexic. So no matter what the normal or abnormal finding is, please go back to the PFC MVP component, nutritional adequacy. And for a lot more detail, go to the companion guide where the different medications, the different nutrients that are involved in correcting orthostatic hypotension are reviewed in detail.